Welcome everyone to the Global MOOC and Online Education Conference 2021. This is Subforum 4, Virtual Mobility and Co-Curricular Programming. And I wish at the beginning to thank President Chu Yong, Tsinghua University, for hosting this event. The overall theme of the conference is Together for a Shared Future, Leading Higher Education Innovation in the New Digital Era. So during this session, we will explore the policies and practices in driving innovation for the higher education sector that is required in this new digital era. And we will also showcase ideas and initiatives to build more open, integrative, and resilient universities. So the goals of this conference include deepening international exchanges and cooperation, accelerating the building up of infrastructure for communication, promoting the openness and sharing of MOOC and online education resources, and finally, collaborating to build, develop, and promote MOOC and online education to better serve society. So in this forum, we will take a deeper look into virtual mobility and co-curricular programming to share the potential of digital technologies in providing students with an opportunity to connect with peers worldwide, to acquire new knowledge and skills, exchange ideas and culture, and develop connections vital for success in the 21st century. And I also welcome you all on behalf of APRU. And for those of you who do not know APRU, we are a network of 61 research universities spread around the Pacific Ocean, Asia, North and South America, and Australasia. And you can see on the slide where our 61 members are located. We use our collective knowledge and connectivity to address with urgency the overlapping crises that humanity faces. And in doing this, we partner with the public and private sectors and with other international organizations. And we address global challenges as a core objective. And we pursue this through the four work streams you see on the slide: shaping higher education in the Pacific, creating global leaders, solving Asia-Pacific challenges, and advocating through high-level policy dialogue. And we have many programs and activities focused in these areas. But especially relevant in this session, and you'll see on the next slide, is a recent initiative in international higher education. APRU universities came together in August 2020 to launch the APRU Virtual Student Exchange Program, led by the Chinese University of Hong Kong, with a unique proposition: co-curricular activities which focus on cultural, leadership, career, and social aspects of study abroad experiences in virtual delivery. Finally, in this introduction, I wish to thank our hosts again, President Chu Yong of Tsinghua and the board chair of Global MOOC Alliance, Wang Xiaoxiao, Secretary General of the Alliance, and Dr. Jan Tao, Director of UNESCO IITE. And I welcome you again and wish you all a productive and enjoyable experience of this year's Global MOOC and Online Education Conference. I now wish quickly to proceed so that we can get underway to introduce our speakers for the first part of this session. And it is a special pleasure that all our speakers are from APRU universities. They will each spend 5 minutes addressing two questions. How has the pandemic shaped the way your university approaches international student exchange and learning experiences? And secondly, what are the opportunities for education and virtual mobility experiences to influence the future of humanity with regard to the crises we face, for example, in health and the pandemic, climate change, inclusiveness and diversity? So I welcome our first speaker, Professor Alan Chan, Provost, and J.S. Lee, Professor of Chinese Culture at the University of Hong Kong. Professor Chan, over to you. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, Chris. Hello, everybody. Delighted to be able to join you. Well, it's evening in Hong Kong. I'm very, very happy to be able to join you at this webinar. I suppose I don't need to belabor the point how the COVID-19 pandemic has impacted on what we do in the classroom, in research, teaching and learning, student experience. For us at CUHK, which works with over 300 partners in some 30 countries, we have a large global learning and student mobility program, which has been tremendously adversely impacted by the pandemic, which also has forced us to re-examine what we would quote unquote normally do in teaching and learning, and also in global education. I know I only have 5 minutes at my disposal, so please let me just share three simple points. First, the pandemic has really compelled us to renew our commitment to internationalization. I mean, all of a sudden, the campus has become so quiet. All of a sudden, students are nowhere to be found. I mean, for us as a global, international, highly international university, then all of a sudden you realize that things you might have taken for granted in the past, they are so central to what we do as a knowledge enterprise. Global learning, international student exchanges, these are not peripheral to what we do here at CUHK, but really has been a part of our DNA from the inception of the university back in 1963. I still remember, I mean, the first international exchange agreement we signed with the University of California system, and that went back, that dates back to 1965. So the first point I want to make is that the pandemic has reinforced our commitment to global learning and academic collaboration. And it has also made us realize how important international academic alliances and networks are, and the central role that they can play in making sure that although international travel may have come to a stop, learning doesn't. That's why we are so happy to be able to work with APRU in developing, well, not just the virtual student exchange program, which I will talk a little bit about later on, but other initiatives as well. The second point, and I think this will come up throughout this conference, and that is how technology has come to the rescue and how educational technology has helped create many new opportunities, open new possibilities for global learning and research. I think CUHK is relatively lucky because we have been investing in educational technology much earlier, long before the start of the pandemic. So we were able to switch all our classes online within a very short period of time. But then we have also learned valuable lessons, and that is educational technology is not simply a matter of investing in hardware. We must also at the same time, if not even more importantly, invest in the software to enable both our faculty members, our teachers, and students to optimize, to leverage the benefits that educational technologies afford. So we spend a lot of time talking about how best to engage our students in virtual space, And we are just delighted how the community has come together and how warmly our students have responded to new modes of teaching and learning. And in this context, we also saw the opportunity to fill the gap left in the global student mobility space and came up with this virtual student exchange program idea. And we are so grateful that APRU has adopted it and it has come to fruition last year. I mean, this is not a small scale program. It involved over 30 universities. Last year, we were able to offer some 175 courses with several hundred students enrolled. Now, the point that I want to emphasize, the details of the program, my colleague, Ms. Shelley Fan, will be able to share with you a bit more later on. But the point I want to emphasize here is that we were able to also incorporate a cultural dimension into the VSE, into the Virtual Student Exchange Program, that involved many students from different countries. We also added some social interactive element into the program, and that has proven to be very, very effective. Now, I think from this experience, we have come to realize that even should international travel become possible again in the near future, there is tremendous value in such virtual programs. And we will definitely be working with other APRU partners to see how we can further enhance the virtual student exchange program. At the same time, we also realized that student exchange should be complemented by other global learning opportunities virtually. And we are also quite fortunate in being able to rally the support of the entire university community in coming up with a good number of shorter term global learning student experience opportunities. Let me simply share one example with you here, and that is a program that we again partnered with APRU in developing an APRU student global climate change simulation, which is essentially a role-playing simulation exercise where students from APRU member universities formed multi-country, multidisciplinary teams to play the role of delegates to the UN climate change negotiations, or online or in virtual space, but with palpable enthusiasm, noticeable a positive reaction from all those who have taken part in the program. I can name several other examples, but I do not really want to take too much time away from from our other speakers. Let me also close by say a final point. And that is, despite the value that educational technologies offer, and there is no question that we must continue to invest in them because they really allow us to scale up some global learning programs, some exchange programs, and it also gives us more flexibility to customize different programs for different student bodies. But having said that, I think it is also important to point out that an important lesson we have learned during the pandemic is the continued importance of the human touch. We took pains really to reach out to every single exchange student, to reach out to all our international students, to make sure that in this difficult time, they are well looked after, connecting them with other students on campus, connecting them with well, you know, their home universities as well. I know Chris is looking at me. That means I should be stopping very soon. But I think, to conclude, this experience has really taught us the importance of coming together as a global body to make sure that learning and research can continue, not only continue, but flourish in difficult times. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Alan. That's wonderful. And the Chinese U has been a wonderful contributor in this difficult time. It's now my pleasure to introduce the second speaker, Professor Sui-Min Xu, Vice President, Education and International Affairs, and a professor of mechanical engineering at Shanghai Jiao Tong University. Professor, please go ahead.
Hi, good evening, Christopher and everyone. Thank you so much for the opportunity to share our thoughts. I wonder if you could see my screen. Hello?
Not yet.
Not yet? Oh, something wrong.
Yes, now.
Okay, you see it now. Okay. Thank you. To answer the question, the two questions that Chris raised, I would like to share on behalf of Shanghai Jiao Tong University about our thoughts and how we build global networks for teaching and learning through the pandemic period and the post-pandemic as well. So what we would like to share is that our thoughts about how to transform this challenge to opportunities from the following 3 points. First of all, we would like to expand the horizons with online interactions to cultivate students' multicultural awareness and global competence on campus, which means that post-pandemic, even after that, we won't be able to have everyone to go abroad for exchange, but on campus with the online facility, we could allow the students to get this cultural experience and build up the awareness. It's just like a Chinese old saying, 秀才不出门,静知天下事. Also, the second point is that, as mentioned earlier, the new technologies, especially online technologies, have been developed through this difficult time under the pressure, but it's been very productive and feasible. So we could use that for teaching and learning, enhanced teaching and learning, in addition to the in-class room teaching and learning. Third would be allowing our students to know the local and the global challenges, to take the responsibility. So we want to, through this, to build their global confidence for all students as a global citizen to contribute to the United Nations SDG. And then in particular, our solutions actions have been taken, for example, the upgrading the existing bilateral collaborations to a hybrid mode. And for example, our SGTO World Week Global Challenge Summer Program focusing on SDGs. And the second is that we have moved bilateral to trilateral and multilateral. Through this is only feasible or very feasible through the online. Otherwise the travel and all the costs and other things will be some difficulty to overcome. to have this multilateral collaborations and interactions online, which is the advantage. So for example, the trilateral collaboration, actually we have done that with UC Davis and Tech de Monterey, the Global Classroom and SDGs, and the multilateral collaborations cover the APRU virtual student exchange programs and also SJTU Warwick, Hong Kong U, Cornell, Toronto virtual internship program. And the other thing is about this 2021 SJTU 4C challenge, 24 hours design contest, which has been very, very successful. So in particular for the Warwick Global Challenge Summer Program, we have had 30 SJTU students and 30 Warwick students from different disciplines. And we have faculty members from different diverse backgrounds. And we focused on, have the students focus on four SDG themes. And the working groups actually got a lot of the students from the feedback. The students feel that they got interdisciplinary research skills, presentation skills, and also a set of different perspectives on issue of greater relevance to all of us, and a new set of friends and contacts in different departments, even on our campus. Sometimes those students don't meet with each other from different departments. And then the trilateral collaboration was built through the Global Classroom and SDGs. And we have parallel classes and also joint SDG seminars. From UC Davis, we have had 58 students registered and ours 27 students. And we have the, afterwards we have the posters and the reports. And then the cross intercultural a group discussion, which has been very beneficial found by the students for the cross-cultural peer learning. And then the multilateral collaborations, APRU virtual student exchange program has really provided a timely helping hand for every student who wishes to get international experience and stay connected with their peers, colleagues, students around the world. And it's warmly received and very popular in SJTU community. And also our Warwick, Hong Kong U, Cornell, Toronto virtual internship program has really enriched the students' experience regarding the career preparations and evoke their intercultural awareness. And we also have a set of shared courses and joint build courses through the Global Virtual Classroom. So all these efforts have been very welcomed by the students and also well participated by our faculty members. And then the 4C challenge design, 24 hours design contest, we could see that you know, there were a lot of participants from all over the world, and we have In 2020, we had 200 more than 200 registrants and from 52 international institutes. And then this year, we have had over more than 300 registrants and then 70 invited institutes. So it's very popular and very positive. And then the results was very, impressive as well. Then at the last, but not the least, we welcome you to participate our summer camp, which is online, focusing on SDG, that will be in July, and focusing on the SDG themes, and also will be student-driven discussion and research. Students will be grouped, and then attention to given to the diversity in culture and the disciplines. Thank you so much. The schedule here, week one, week two, and week, it's a 4-week
Thank you so much.
So welcome everyone. And if you're interested, please contact us. The contact information is at the bottom. So thank you.
It's wonderful to see such a wide range of initiatives. Thank you so much, Professor Hsu. I'm sure we've all learned a lot from that. And it's now my pleasure to move on to the final speaker for this part of the program, Professor Eduardo Vera Sobrino, Director of International Affairs, and another Professor of Engineering and Physics at University of Chile. Professor Vera, please.
Thank you very much. It's a real pleasure to and an honor to share this conference with our colleagues from prestigious universities that are facing all these challenges and this new world that we face so suddenly 2 years ago. So let me put the share screen here. We see whether you are seeing it. Not yet.
Not yet. There must be a tsunami in the middle of the Pacific. here we go.
Okay, here we go. Okay, sorry. So let me share with you the profound impact of IT in research and education that we faced at University of Chile. And the APRU virtual student exchange has been a fantastic laboratory to really understand how it was an emergency that we, as some previous speakers have said, that we had to move all our courses suddenly into online. And again, in the case of University of Chile, also fortunately we were prepared. I mean, there's been a lot of investment done in and leadership in IT development. So we did have good platforms in place to be able to face this challenge. But also we really never probably predicted the profound impact it would have in-house. I mean, because basically, as you all have seen, I mean, doing online courses opens very different avenues, and it's a clearly very different. It's a very different experience than the normal classes that we used to have. So basically it has had a profound impact both in research and in teaching. I mean, suddenly we have a significantly scaled up level of international collaboration. University of Chile is a very research-based university, and we had in place a lot of international collaboration, but suddenly the level of international collaboration, once our borders were closed, we realized the significance of having those human networks in place and activating them in a very significant way through the IT means. And also that meant speeding up the in-house internationalization and bringing a lot of cultural diversity into our daily classes and our daily research meetings. in a scale that we had not imagined was possible. And this is because it's not only, I mean, it has brought really a cultural change in the way that we do our research once we couldn't move physically from places. Actually, we couldn't go to the university. In the case of Santiago, we had a very strong and very severe lockdown for months. So that meant a complete change in-house as well. So this the opening all these very strong links, or activating all these strong links that we have internationally, happened in parallel with a significant change in the way that we worked and approached our daily life from our homes. And of course, that meant that the local problems had, we were bringing global perspective into them, because having in our own classes, students from other countries and from very diverse backgrounds was very interesting. One thing is that in the APRU experiment, most of the exchange students participating in our classes also had English as a second language. And that incredibly helped immensely our own students to feel much more confident in using this English as a medium of instruction. What we have found out is that probably in about 90% of the cases, that's what our surveys have found, this was not a high barrier for the academic learning. The advantages of this diversity in the classroom really surpassed whatever barrier using a different a language other than our native language would bring. So the IT-based education has allowed us to share and transfer knowledge in a completely different way, and it has also allowed us to obtain very new data about learning process. Learning analytics is something that has boomed as a real research area in education, and our Institute of Advanced Education has really brought a lot of attention into understanding all the data that we can obtain from our classes online. So, but the profound impact of the democratization of the international experience, bringing all this on a massive scale. We used to have about 1% of our students going abroad because of the cost. And democratizing this international experience has really brought very significant impact in our academic activities. So one thing is that we also believe that the virtual student exchange does not replace, but it promotes in-person mobility, which we hope to resume once the pandemic is over, or at least in the post-pandemic when we know how to cope with the pandemic as we're learning right now. We used to have, as I was saying, just a small percentage of person mobility, and we believe that virtual mobility will really push this limit, because it's not only the economic barrier, sometimes it's the self-confidence of a student of being able to, I mean, sometimes he's shy to go to our country because he thinks that this will be a challenge that overwhelms him. But if he has this virtual experience in the first years of his education, it's much easier for that student to take that step and be very motivated to have in-person mobility later. So what are the technological challenges we faced? And in the case of University of Chile, we really created a vice presidency of IT, because IT no longer was just a medium, but it was a core aspect of our teaching and learning. So the online education has had a very significant increase in momentum and will become a very significant part of our academic activity. So now, of course, slowly, the sanitary condition of Chile is much better. We have about 90% of our population now vaccinated. So we're going back to our classrooms. But what we're finding is that life is different. I mean, it's absolutely impossible to go back to the pre-pandemic era. And we, in our post-pandemic era, we will be living in a hybrid age. We're getting used to having all these meetings where part of the people are present and part are remote. And this is becoming very natural. So teachers have adopted technology, but have created new ways of using that technology that were really not in place before. So we have a completely different baseline to go ahead into the new era. And some students are back, but probably we will never have all our students back, although for us, the human contact is essential, and we will not become a fully online university, but we will be in a hybrid situation. About 20% of our students actually come from cities in the regions. So how they will combine the experience remotely and inside is something that we are still working out how to do it in the best way. So the APRU was the first virtual student exchange program that we've had. But this has really influenced what we're doing in other networks. We belong to a network here in Latin America, the group of Montevideo universities, Argentina, Uruguay, Brazil, Chile, also are doing an experiment now of virtual mobility. And some of the experiences that we really did ahead in APRU have influenced a lot what we're doing in the region. So there's a lot of cultural and experience exchange that's flowing worldwide.
Thank you so much. I think you can, I'm sorry to interrupt.
Yeah, sure.
But yeah. We're running close to time. Can you?
Yeah, I'll wrap up. We're doing MOOC courses on climate change, renewable energies, and artificial intelligence and social networks. And where the very unique things happening in Chile in these areas, and we want to share that within our community. Thank you very much.
Thank you, this is wonderful. And we've had such a rich tapestry of experience from our three speakers. I'd like to thank them all. Thank you all for that. And because we're running a little short of time, it's my task now to hand over to our next moderator, Jackie Wong, to moderate the case studies by practitioners. And again, thank you all to our speakers.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Jackie Agnello Wong. I'm from the Association of Pacific Rim Universities, where I am the Director of Network and Student Programming. To get to the chase quickly, I know that we're running a little bit behind. I just want to share a little bit about what to expect during this panel, which we'll be sharing with you lessons from our virtual mobility experiences. We'll be exploring ways that co-curricular activities and academic courses provide unique exchange experiences and assist students in discovering their own leadership and global citizenship skills. And we also will offer insights into the future of virtual student exchange. So with that, I'd like to welcome my colleague, Ms. Shelley Fan, who is the Director of Academic Links at the Chinese University of Hong Kong, to start the panel today. Ms. Shelley Fan, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Jackie. Let me just run my PowerPoint up. Okay. So my name is Shelley Fan. I am from the Chinese University of Hong Kong. and I am the university's director of academic links. I'd just like to spend a few seconds talking about the university to give you a background. So the Chinese University of Hong Kong is the second oldest university in Hong Kong. We are a comprehensive research university with 8 faculties. We have a very unique college system whereby all students belong to a faculty for their major program, and they belong to one of the 9 colleges, which provides the leadership and whole person education, as well as global engagement opportunities to the students. From the very beginning, international education has been our core mission. We are one of the first people in Asia to have international education and student mobility. The university was set up in 1963, and our first student exchange partnership was set up in 1965. With the University of California system. So today we have close to 300 partner universities in over 35 countries and regions. And every year we have over 1,000 students who do the term time bilateral exchange programs. And we have over 5,000 students who participate in various forms of international experiential learning, field trips, internship, language learning, so on and so forth. And in return, we have about 1,500 students who come and visit us every year. So, you know, because international education and exchanges is so common at the university, when the pandemic hit, it was a huge impact for us and for our students. And we knew that this was a common problem with all our partner universities. And with that, you know, we also saw everybody adapting to online learning and teaching. So in mid last year, 2020, we conceived the idea of developing a virtual student exchange under the Association of Pacific Rim Universities, which has 61 universities in the Americas, Asia, and Australasia. And it really is about a platform, providing a platform so that students would be able to receive international education and experience from some of the best universities around the world without having to leave home. Our objective is to provide a holistic exchange experience just like the one that students would get when they travel abroad. So we're looking at an academic experience where students would acquire new knowledge and skills. And because this is a digital program, students would develop digital competencies. We would provide a co-curricular aspect of the program where we would train students for the future workplace and also allow them to discover new cultures and societies. And there's a huge social piece to that, where we bring students together from around the world and where they form friendships and professional networks that they could use in the future. There are 2 distinctive components to the program. There's the academic courses and the co-curricular programs. The academic courses are mostly credit bearing and they are contributed by the participating universities within the APRU network. The courses are synchronous, asynchronous, or in various hybrid modes. In fact, we're asking all the students now for some feedback, and I'd be interested to hear what other modes of delivery that they have received in their academic courses. And we run 3 periods of study each year. Since our launch in August 2020, we've had 32 university offering courses, over 470 courses open to students, close to 3,000 applications and over 1,200 enrollments. And through this program, we have connected 35 students from 35 universities in 16 economies. The courses are rich because the universities that offer the courses so far represent 13 economies from around the world, from in Asia, Indonesia, Japan, Hong Kong, Korea, all the way to North America, Mexico, Chile, and then to South America and North America, in the US, and also to Australia. The courses are in diverse disciplines. So at the moment, we're not limited on what to offer. And universities are really playing around with what might work for an international audience. So those courses allow students to learn about new cultures and places. They've allowed students to continue with their major program of study but to explore new content that may not be available at their home university. There are courses that are helping students to prepare for the workplace, and particularly courses that are very tech-driven. So besides the curricular program, the academic program, a very important part of the program is the co-curricular program. This is what you would have outside of the classroom if it was to be a face-to-face exchange. These are really, you know, places and platforms to allow students to learn about new ideas and cultures and to bring together experts, academics, and students. Broadly, we have four areas of co-curricular program: cultural, leadership, career, and social. The programs so far, since our launch in August 2020, we've had 17 universities contributing 73 co-curricular programs that have attracted 1,500 individual participations. A lot of the students, 60% of them come from Asia, and then about 25% come from the Americas, and then about 10 to 11% coming from Australasia. The delivery of these courses, programs and activities are very flexible. So they can be in a webinar mode where it's primarily one direction. Some of them are able to engage and interact with the audience through chat box and Slido, where you know you have polling. We've hosted a lot of virtual tours where it's live and it's a very immersive experience, and where you have the tour guide, sometimes students themselves, interacting with the local community. We've had activities that's very hands-on. So we've had music jams and cooking classes where we've provided students with instructions on what to do. They get all their ingredients and we make it all at the same time. And there's been a lot of discussions, and it's mainly student-driven to do a lot of cultural sharing. So I'll go through some of the activities. You know, for the cultural ones, the objective is really to excite students. And as Eduardo talked about previously, to promote student exchange face-to-face. So we excite students, we get them stimulated to think about coming, you know, going to a certain place once they learn about the culture at the other university. And here are the two examples I've chosen today, one about Korea U and the other one about sake drinking. We've run leadership program, and they are mainly very focused on globalization. And for example, the University of California, Davis, they've been running a Becoming a Global Leader leadership series that's very selective. There's only a small group of about 25 students, but many, many applicants applying to that program. We focused on career, you know, helping students to prepare for getting the right job, to allowing them to think about other opportunities in research, innovation, and entrepreneurship once they graduate. And we have a lot of social programs, you know, and I think that one part of the social program that's been very helpful is to allow students to think about and to learn about their own culture and country, and to serve as ambassadors. And finally, you know, it's not just limited to the four areas that I talked about, and there are many more fun and inspiring activities that we've run. And it's great fun. Not only do we have students, but we also have administrators and faculty members joining these activities also. Besides providing the opportunity for students, the UPRO Virtual Student Exchange Program has allowed us to build a network of among the member universities to exchange good practices, and also to think about and to work on future collaboration. Earlier this year, we hosted a workshop on developing co-curricular programs to support virtual student mobility, and that's been extremely helpful in allowing us to brainstorm the what next steps and how we could evolve this program. So what do the students have to say? I think the feedback so far has been that they have aligned very much with our original objectives for the program. So the first two students have said that, you know, that has really inspired them to study abroad post-COVID. One student has said that, you know, her mind is already there, although she's physically not there. And we know that students have met people from around the world and really engaged in intercultural communication, and that the wide range of courses and universities has been very attractive. So our efforts so far has been well recognized by partner universities and around the world. Last year, we made it to the finalist in the digital education category in the Falling Walls Science Breakthrough of the Year. And then this year, our program has been shortlisted in the International Strategy of the Year category under the Times Higher Education Awards for Asia in 2021. And fingers crossed, we will know the results next week. So that's my last slide. Thank you.
Sorry. Thank you, Shelley, Van, for your presentation. It was really nice to see the illustration of the examples that have taken place during the virtual student exchange program. I now welcome Mr. Yang Seung-hyun, who is the Manager of International Mobility and the Cooperation Team.
Thank you.
At the Korea University. Thank you.
Thank you, Jackie. And thank you, Shelley, for giving an idea what the VSC program is about. My name is Seung-hyun Yang. I am manager at the Office of International Affairs at Korea University. I have been pretty much involved in every stage of the APRU VSC program on our university side, from designing course lineup to producing and providing co-curricular programs. So I like to share best practices and considerations and challenges based on my experience. So let me put on my share slide. So when we decided to join the APRU VSC program, our process started with finding the right answers to the four questions. I'm going to share how we identified the raised questions and our strategies to address the different issues in the following slides. Our first consideration was why students choose to study at Korea University through the VSC program. And students wish it to take online courses because maybe they are interested in Korea, or they wish it to have international education experience outside their country, or developing an awareness of different concepts by discussing with peers, or it may just be curiosity. So we learned that there is indeed a market for our online course offerings among international students around the globe. The next consideration was, what courses should we provide for students, and how can you provide a KU experience virtually? Our solution was composed of Korean studies related courses, which were popular among our international students, including business administration, media, international relations, Korean history, and linguistics. So the students take whatever courses they might take at their home university, but through Korean perspective. Moving to co-curricular activities, when students go abroad for a semester or a year, they expect to have real experience, something that they can have through Google search or reading travel books. So instead, they like to go through the perceptual processes, explore the areas, taste local food, make new friends, and participate in different culture activities. So we have been thinking of what would be best to develop cultural awareness of Korea and Korea University. And we have come up with the four programs. The Korea University Student Life Revealed was an opportunity to give our virtual students a sense of what it's like to be a KU student by live streaming campus life, including campus tours and socializing with domestic students. The history of K-pop was a webinar lecture that took you deep dive into a world of K-pop from its historical development to recent issues that uncover the truth behind the highly stylized modern showbiz phenomena. The Tiger Pride introduced the most unique aspect of Korea University's cheerleading culture. So students who participated in the virtual program felt the passion that KU students have for their alma mater as they shared their thoughts on cheering and how it strengthens their love and attachment to the Korea University. The Palace of Joseon featured historically significant paintings, scientific instruments, and maps housed at Korea University Museum. Together with an art historian, the program provided an intimate look at life during the Joseon Dynasty. So our co-curricular program were meant to give a sense of our unique university culture. We received many positive feedbacks from participants, and some of the students expressed their desire to continue their study with us again in person when it's possible. And through our experience with the co-curricular program, we learned that students appreciate programs, particularly those that attempt to make up what they might be lacking by not physically being in Korea. Going back to our consideration, our third question was, how could we deliver such courses effectively? We understand the purpose of providing virtual programs is to overcome travel constraints. Therefore, we wanted to utilize online courses, online courseworks inherent in features fully. As a result, our course lineups for APRUVSE are in both synchronized and asynchronous modes, and alternative assignments are given for virtual students if they are necessary. With these extra efforts in inclusive delivery modes, we are able to include all time zones. Actually, we have a few students from the University of Chile located opposite Korea on the globe, but taking on-demand lectures and participating in discussions at a designated time worked very well for them. So we learned that flexibility in online course delivery is essential. For example, regarding coursework deadlines, times of classes, live or recorded lectures, and etc. Our last consideration was, what are the benefits of participating in the program as a partner institution? The network-wise benefits by participating in a multilateral VSA program, we are able to more quickly implement the program to respond to student needs for an international experience without travel. In addition, working with existing partners within APRU, we were able to more quickly be flexible, which is important when developing new programs. In the university-wise benefits, the virtual students bring new ideas as they see culture and social phenomena in different perspectives, and exchanging diverse viewpoints with peers makes truly global virtual classrooms. Also, the APRU VSE program helped us to more effectively share our success story around the globe within the international education community. Therefore, we hope to continue growing this program with our trust by working together with other partner universities. So this was what I wanted to share with you regarding our experience on the VSE program. Thank you for listening to my presentation.
Thank you, Mr. Yang from Korea University. It was really interesting to hear how you really creatively hosted these co-curricular activities. And with that flexibility, keeping in mind that students are joining from all over the world. Next, I'd like to bring Dr. Wang Xiaoxiao, who is the Secretary General of the Global MOOCs Alliance at Tsinghua University. Professor Wang, the floor is yours.
Good evening, good afternoon, good morning, all my colleagues, and I'm happy to be here to share our practice and our perspectives with you, and I really appreciate the leadership of April and also BSE program. And Tsinghua University launched the Global Hybrid Classroom in early 2021, enabling Tsinghua students and overseas university students to attend the same class to build a locally global classroom. And we would like to launch student research training program next semester among those who have also studied together for one or two semesters together to promote global online collaboration between Chinese and overseas students. And we were very delighted to join April VSE this fall, which brought us more and more quality educational resources. And we were also delighted to receive such a big group of international students to our campus virtually during this difficult time. And we look forward to deeper cooperation in the near future. Well, to address more and more demands from the globe, we also launched a series of global open courses to welcome more students without the need for credits. We just launched 8 courses in this semester. And since the launch of October 19, now we attracted more than 2.3 million learners. And now we can see a lot of feedbacks from students, like the NTU students said that hybrid teaching mode not only retains the interactive nature of the classroom, but also increases the flexibility of the course schedule. And one of our students who attended a class, a course from the April VSE courses said that I have had opportunity to experience university life in a different cultural setting. And I would also like to introduce our Global MOOC Alliance, like some of the virtual exchange students are from this alliance. Like Global MOOC Alliance was founded in 2020 with 20 global partners across 6 continents. And we focus on joint teaching, capacity building, knowledge sharing, and public advocacy. I would like to answer 2 very important questions which could help me to sum up my presentation. The first is that the principle of virtual exchange from the past 18 months. I think a key principle of the virtual exchange is open. Well, universities should open more resources and faculty should be more open to embrace overseas students, even they're from the other institutions. Actually, after COVID-19, we found that there is a big increase of open, at the university level, the institutional level, and at the faculty's personal level. Part of the reason is because that faculty and more faculty are familiar, are used to online learning and also live streaming. However, there is still need for more open as we need more courses and also to be more inclusive. Universities also should take actions to launch supportive policies to encourage faculty to open their courses. There are still obstacles when we open more and more courses. I think many of my colleagues have the same perspectives on this. And given the future of the virtual student exchange, I believe that more and more universities will join this movement. And we have already seen this trend, partly because that many places are still locked down and the travel is still banned. The international travels are still banned in some regions. And one of the biggest reasons that students love this kind of flexible schedule is that some students do not want to take a whole semester or whole year outside the university or abroad, maybe because it's too time consuming or it is a big, huge financial burden for them. So there will be another alternative for them to study. Can still access to other institutions' quality educational resources. And here is something in my mind. There might be a global online campus where worldwide students could select courses from any universities or higher education institutions like CUHK, University of Chile, Chula Longgong, and Shanghai Jiao Tong, etc. So he or she is, they can select any courses they are interested in from these kinds of institutions and with online learning, and their whole degree may consist of the courses from different institutions. So that might be a future map of the virtual exchange. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Dr. Wong. It's really impressive to see what you've built with the MOOCs Alliance. May I also now ask Dr. Voraprapa Nakavachara from Chulalongkorn University. She is the assistant to the president for global engagement.
Hi, thank you very much, Jackie. Let me please share my screen and I'll start. Okay. Thank you everyone for having me today. So it's my pleasure to be here. Let me first start talking about the future of online education and virtual mobility. So I think it's a conversation that's exciting to me. We already know where we are now, and now we're looking forward to see what we're going to become or where we're going next. But let me start with where we are now, and then I'll start talking about where I think we'll be in the future. So now we have seen that the pandemic accelerated digital transformation. So in terms of learning, everything moved online overnight. And in terms of physical exchange, so it was not possible to have the physical exchange. So we had the virtual student exchange in which CUHK already initiated and present their very good program, and then many and all of us have joined. So I think for this that we have accomplished, I think it has proven that learning anywhere together is possible, and exchanging ideas without having to meet in person is also possible, and also co-curricular activities without actually meeting in person is possible. And I think this kind of like open door to a bigger thing in the future. And I'll talk about that a little bit later, but it's exciting. This is an experiment on the current event, but it's opened the doors to some new excitement about online learning. Okay, so I think another thing that was done and was accomplished during the VSC is that we were also able to do credit transfer cross-registration, so it was made possible. And I think this can be engaged further in the future, that we can come from anywhere. We can be a global citizen, and we can graduate from our own university and attend other university at the same time as well. So thinking about post-pandemic, so what would the learning looks like? So I think many people already thought about hybrid learning, meaning it's online plus offline, because after the pandemic, we'll be able to travel again, but then not everyone can travel all the time. So I think the online component will still be there. So it will be hybrid. And I would like to focus on the three things that I think are the other skills that students need to have post-pandemic. The first item that I would like to discuss is about the digital disruption. So basically, digital disruption already happened, and it has accelerated during the pandemic, and it will continue to happen again faster and faster. So I think our workforce need to be future ready, meaning that not only that they need to equip with digital literacy, but also they should be able to learn new technology very quickly so that they can adapt quickly in the fast changing world. And this is something that we need to equip them with. Okay. Another thing is about the VUCA world. I think many people might have heard about this word many times already. So so it means we are in the volatile world. We come from volatile. You come from uncertain, so it's also a lot of uncertainty in this world. The problems are also complex and it's ambiguous. So to give you an example of the VUCA world, just like this COVID-19 pandemic. So the situation has been volatile, it's never stable. There's a lot of uncertainty, we don't know what's gonna happen. The issue is complex and also ambiguous. So we need very good leaders to bring us through. So I think the skills that the students need to have is how to become a resilient leaders, meaning they'll be not only that they're smart and they can make the decision, but they also need to bounce back from the problems that will come up. So this is the second thing that I think is important. And the last thing are SDGs. So we still need to keep our world for our future generations. We need to make sure that we have enough resources left for them, and we need to make sure that we don't pollute too much. So I think this is why SDGs have been important and will still be important in the next decades or more. I think so it's important that we make sure that our students know and understand about SDGs and why it's important and why they also need to contribute to solve this environmental social problems. So this is other things that I think important post-pandemic. But I want to invite you to investigate further and looking into the future. And I see something that's very exciting. So I think I already mentioned that the VSE is sort of like it's like a proof that learning anywhere together is possible. And but we don't stop here. I think in the future we can open a new door to the bigger thing. So if we can learn together anywhere in the world, why not do it in the metaverse? So I think many people might have heard about this word. It's a buzz in the past month. So I think if you hear what Facebook has done, Mark Zuckerberg said he has transformed Facebook into Meta. So it's a new name now. We don't call it Facebook now, we call it Meta. And he said he will focus on the metaverse. So basically it's the virtual world where people come and hang out in your own avatar. So if you can come hang out, why don't you come and study together? Why don't you come and have the co-curricular activity together? And I think it's not far away anymore. If you have watched the movie, Ready Player One or The Matrix, that's what I'm talking about. And it's gonna happen. Maybe not tomorrow, but I don't think it's that far away. So if you look at what Facebook has done, Facebook has just launched the thing called Facebook Horizon Workroom. So it's not just like Zoom meeting. It's like you actually have your own avatar, like 3D avatar going in there, and you actually can transport your equipment into that virtual room. So basically, if you type something, your friends in that room can also see your screen sort of. Or I think another thing that I always like to give example, there's a virtual world for runners. So this is something that I like to join. If you see the photo on the bottom, the bottom middle on the bottom right, so that's actually me running in the virtual world. So basically activities can be done. So in the pandemic, I like to go running, but sometimes I cannot go out running because the park is closed, or I don't feel safe going out because the COVID-19 pandemic was so scary for me. So what I did is I ran on my treadmill, but I connect my treadmill to the virtual world, and I joined the virtual world, and I ran with a lot of people from anywhere around the world. So this is already happening. So why is it that education cannot happen in the virtual world? So I think it's coming next. It just right now it's scattering. Right now people create a virtual world for one thing or two things, but it's not the virtual world for everything. I think the metaverse will be the virtual world where you can do anything. You can come in for a meeting. Maybe some Nobel laureate will come in with his own avatar and give a lecture and a big lecture hall somewhere in the metaverse, and anyone in the world can just go in and enjoy that lecture, because they already did a concert in metaverse. Why not a Nobel laureate lecture? And also like activities like running, watching movies, or conducting science experiment, attend a dance class, or even go to the Disneyland in the metaverse. I think this is something that's exciting and can happen. So if you look at Mark Zuckerberg's status on Meta a few days ago, he said he just heard that Stanford will offer a class taught completely in virtual reality, and he would have stayed in school longer if he were taught in VR. So I think this will be exciting, not just for me, not just for the student, but for anyone. And then we now talking about lifelong learning. So people at any age can come in and join in this world. So we know that learning can happen anywhere, anytime. So why not the metaverse? Why not connect and join together? So, and I'm very excited to see how this will pan out. So that's the end of my talk. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Vora. That's really exciting to hear your enthusiasm about the metaverse, but also how we can adapt it for education use. I'd like to invite all of our panelists to share with us their cameras. I'd like to just do one follow-up round of questions and ask you here to be quick. We did save some time on our presentation. So if you could just take maybe a minute or two just to answer some of the questions we have prepared. Do we have Dr. Wong? Okay, so let me start with Mr. Yang. So you talked a lot about providing a very holistic perspective and experience for students with the cheerleading co-curricular activities, as well as K-pop and others. I thought that it was really just such a good experience for students to have that in a virtual setting. Maybe could you share with us maybe some of the challenges that you experience when developing the online content for these types of co-curricular activities, and maybe share with us some of the difficult parts. I think that would be very beneficial for all of us listening.
The idea of introducing Korean culture and Korean universities campus life was good, but never an easy task to do, because as an administrator, we had no background knowledge about creating such programs and had no idea how much the process required a significant time, commitment, and attention. So, and the most challenging part to me was I had to lead the project as a command of production, like developing contents and forming an ad hoc task force, outsourcing filming and controlling the entire process. However, I enjoyed it very much, and I hope to continue developing the co-curricular programs to assist the students with global citizenship skills.
Yeah. That's a really important thing. Now I'd like to turn to Ms. Sally Fan at the Chinese University of Hong Kong. So you've been shaping our virtual student exchange program from the beginning and really have built something that has presented itself in the pandemic era that we're in now. I think it would be really helpful for us to hear from you, your thoughts about how you foresee the development and the future of the virtual student exchange program, how we'll build upon it beyond the pandemic era. And how do you think it can maintain its popularity?
Thank you, Jackie. I think we all get asked that a lot because, you know, particularly, you know, at Chinese University, this semester, we're seeing the incoming exchange students back. And I think with some of our partners here, we're also getting the students, you know, younger than us. Students are very resilient. And, you know, even during the pandemic, they're traveling and they're doing the quarantine. They're trying very much to have life as normal. But you know, I think that with all the experience that we have gained in the past 18 months, that should not go to waste. And there is a lot of opportunity to ride on it, to promote and to prepare face-to-face exchanges. And also, you know, a platform such as a virtual exchange really allows us to increase accessibility and diversity. For students who are, you know, unable to go on exchange for various reasons, they could use this platform. Besides that, I think, you know, it's good for the environment, less carbon footprint, and it does the students a lot of good in terms of accumulating experience. In the past, when we've pre-pandemic, you know, each student may have two, at most three, experiences abroad during their 3 to 4 years of studies. And this is very limited to people who can afford it, basically. But you know, with virtual learning, they can gain more of these experiences because they don't need to spend that money to travel. They don't have to make that extra time to travel. They can fit it into their regular schedule. So we're going to see when students graduate after 3 or 4 years, they're going to have a lot more opportunity, a lot more experience up their sleeves, and they're going to be much more prepared for either, you know, graduate education or the working world. So I do see that it will change, but I think also there is a lot of opportunity for us to continue and to build virtual mobility post-pandemic.
Thank you. Thank you, Ms. Fan, for sharing your expertise on this. I'd like to now turn to Dr. Wong. You shared with us some really important lessons from your experiences in hosting MOOCs and academic programs. I'd like to hear more about your thoughts about what are the ongoing challenges that we continue to face with the focus on virtual courses and co-curricular activities, but also, you know, how are we addressing Zoom fatigue, for example, or how are we adapting to new modes of communication and interacting, maybe the metaverse, for example, too? Dr. Wong?
Thank you, Jackie. Well, because I am in charge of the Global Hybrid Classroom and Virtual Exchange Program at Tsinghua, and I find that we still need to improve the online offline hybrid pedagogy. It's really hard to ignore online students when the number is big, is large, but when there is a small group of international students online, it's much easier for the faculty to ignore them, and they're more likely to integrate them to the offline class students. And how can the faculty integrate the online students effectively and efficiently is the biggest difficulty for our faculty. And we believe that different courses have different features, so different pedagogy should be applied according to the differences. And the second challenge, as I just mentioned, that the university need to take action to launch policies to support the open of the courses. There are challenges like, well, when the extra students join the classes, there is extra burden for faculty. They need to take consideration of their students and integrate them into interaction. And if these students come to study for credits, they need to review their homework, and they need to help them to immerse into the teamwork. So there is extra burden for faculty, and what we can do to help them accept this without too much, no matter a labor burden or financial burden on this. So yes, these are the biggest challenges for me. And I really like the Chula's example of the Metaverse campus. And we will also have another sub forum on this the day after tomorrow. And there will be a lot of expectation on the new technology on campus. And I find that people cannot wait for that. From my perspective, I find that the biggest challenge for the new technology adoption in university is the faculty's acceptance. It's easy to alter or change students' learning behavior, but it's still a little bit difficult for us to change the faculty's teaching behavior. But I think that, maybe during this difficult time, and people must to use online or technology to some extent. So this might be a proper timing for us to introduce new technology, new technical innovation to campus. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Wong. It's really important that universities continue to infuse training practices and pedagogy for our faculty so they can stay on the leading edge of teaching practices, especially with these new technologies. Dr. Vora, I'd like to talk to you about, you know, you presented a grand future, a grand vision for the future of how, you know, virtual mobility could look like and what online education could look like. Could you elaborate on how this can be applied? You said you talked about lifelong learning, you talked about other areas where we could use these types of technologies. And I'd like for you to talk a little bit more about that, but also about some of the key elements of online education in the post-pandemic world.
Yes, thank you. So I think once the technology is ready,
I think we're just transporting what we already have right now into the world, like the metaverse. For example, right now, we already have like MOOC, and we already have like some like credit banks for lifelong learning for people to come back to school and to collect credits and things like that. So why don't you just transport this into the new world? I think the more challenge is building the new world. That's more difficult because it's going to take a little bit more to actually see what it looks like, but someone's building it. And I think that the challenge is more just like Dr. Wang said, I think it's more of the faculty's problem rather than the student problem. Because right now, there's a lot of game that teach you on things. The students are already there. And the faculties need to catch up with all of that. And even the online learning things, the students are learning things by themselves already. And some things not even taught in university yet because some faculties are not like ready to adapt. I think the problem is more of the faculty that needs to be adapt. And sometimes we need to be forced to adapt. For example, right now, like the online learning, I think a lot of people resisted at the beginning. A lot of faculty members resisted, not the students. Students like jump online really quickly, but faculty members, they have to be forced. Just like the university said, well, we closing down, you cannot come anymore. And that day, the faculty member need to switch. So I think the key is the adaptation of older people. I'm not saying older people, but I mean for people who are hard to change. I can't use age. That's age discrimination because some older people are quick to change. But I think for people who are resisted to change, I think that's the challenge. And I think to enter the new world, to actually be able to use the technology to help with the online learning in the future, I think just adapt to change. Be open mind to the new technology, whatever it is. Thank you.
Dr. Wara. So let me just take a minute here to summarize what we talked about today. I wanna thank the 50,000 people in China who are viewing this webinar, and also the almost 7,000 people also viewing the English channel. So thank you all for being a part of this webinar. I just wanna take a minute to say, I wanna say three main points. One, I think we're mastering the art of virtual exchange. And I think we can take these lessons that we've learned with us as we plan for the future. We've learned that we need to be creative and constantly evolving in our practice. The status quo is no longer acceptable. I also want to say that we need to maximize the benefits of working in a network and amplify our network effects. You know, hosting programs in collaboration is quite important. I also want to note that programs and activities need to be precise about our value proposition, and this will keep our students coming back for more virtual student exchange experiences. We know that students are learners, but they're also leaders in many ways. And with regard to cultural competency, we can help students to sharpen their leadership acumen by giving them a journey of self-exploration and discovery. But we can also help them to allow them to become facilitators in intercultural dialogue. This generation is more diverse, more open, and more fluent in intercultural dialogue than any other generation before it. We can make a grand impact on society by the best scenarios that we can offer are those that offer students that spark of that intrinsic motivation to be a part of something that is bigger than themselves and can make a really big impact in society. And we can help students by developing student leadership pipelines. The sustainable development goals is one of these examples. And finally, I just want to say, as we continue virtual student exchange in the next 18 months, I'd like to kind of note some of the lasting elements that we have and some of the lessons that we've learned. CUHK, for example, has done a great deal of institutionalization in developing their virtual student exchange program. And that has helped us to continue our collaboration and to deepen our partnerships. We have developed strategies for lasting engagement of the students and their peers, And we can do this by re-engaging alumni cohorts and giving them leadership roles, for example. And finally, that we should try to marry social good and learning experiences for a lasting impact. So I thank all of our panelists today for offering these lessons and for sharing the experiences that they've had with the virtual student exchange program. Thanks to all of you.
Thank you. Bye-bye. Bye-bye.